aside from both being great for binge viewing, as we heard in the intro, you know, you first think about the topic of this talk. You've got the dark, scheming, fictional Underwoods and the Roosevelts, the most revered and significant bloodline in American politics. So you think of all the differences. Walk me through some of the similarities when you peel back the layers.
Well, I think scheming is a good one. You know, there's a lot of similarity. I think all of these... both of these series get at a kind of sense of an essential human striving. I think it deals with power and ethics, not just on a political sphere, which is the obvious similarities that they share, but on a deeply interpersonal one. And so the story that Jeff and I have tried to tell is an inside-out portrait of three very complicated, deeply flawed, deeply wounded, and incredibly successful people who we say, right in the outset, touch the lives of more Americans than any other family. But it doesn't mean that the story that we're looking for isn't in the same realm of the kind of story that Beau is looking for, I think.
Yeah, when it comes to House of Cards, one of the very first things I said to David Fincher when we got our first phone call about it is that more than the politics, I wanted to tell the story of a marriage. How these two people, extraordinary people, became greater than the sum of the parts. And power for them is the mortar for all the bricks that constitute their lives. And their marriage is really built on a shared desire to be the masters of their own universe. And I think that for anyone who wants to be a president, which is a crazy thing to want to be, right? I at some point, whether it was Franklin or Teddy or Eleanor, even to the extent that she was in that sphere, to think, I'm going to occupy that gleaming White House and be the most powerful person in the free world, is a form of insanity. Because if you think about the weight that's on your shoulders, decisions you have to make, the absurdity of being able, with the stroke of a pen, to change millions of people's lives, how could a sane person, or a completely sane person, possibly live with that presumption that that person should be them? And when it comes to Francis and Claire, for me, I think that I had to ask myself, okay, they both are cut from the same cloth, they both want to be this person or in that sphere, and what is it? Why do people want power? Why is power important? And from a personal human level, for me, power is the closest you come to cheating death. You can't cheat death, you're going to die. That's going to happen, everyone in this room. Aren't we off to a cheery start? but while you're here, you can control and influence the world around you as much as humanly possible. And I think that's what's interesting to people like Francis and Claire and Franklin and Teddy and Eleanor, because it's not petty power, which is about greed or money. It's about actually something existential, a need to try to shape the world around you. And I think that's an endlessly fascinating subject.
And deeply affirmative. And I think that's where, as well as we celebrate with House of Cards the deviousness and the undertow of it, which is present in the Roosevelts, but we also forget that that impulse is itself motivated by that existential drive, but also the sense that that permanence that you create, that immortality that you're able to leave behind, that deposit in marble and stone and law and highway and high school and airport and social security and all of that stuff, does really last well after that inevitable end of you.
Yeah. Well, I think that's true. I was thinking when you were saying about just power. Franklin Roosevelt, I think, was reproducing the world of his childhood. He was the most pampered single child that ever lived. He was surrounded by servants who called him Master Franklin. This is in the United States. And a mother who adored everything he did. He was the center of the universe. And I think he wanted power, and I think he wanted to do good, but I think he was really only comfortable when he was president of the United States, and therefore saw no reason to leave the White House
Right. If it's a, if you have to be insane to want to be president, he wanted it four times.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, let's take a look at this clip about how the Underwoods and the Roosevelts' ideologies line up.
6 days before James and Sarah's baby Franklin was born, Theodore Roosevelt made his first headlines as the brand new Republican assemblyman from Manhattan's 21st district and the youngest man ever elected to the assembly. He was just 23 years old, and Albany had never seen anyone quite like him. He had dropped plans to become a scientist while still at Harvard, then dropped out of Columbia Law School, refused to go into the family business, and finally surprised everyone by deciding to try his hand at Republican politics and run for the assembly. Some of his friends had advised him against it. Politics in either party was no place for a gentleman, they told him. It was a low business run by saloon keepers, horse car conductors, and the like. That merely means that the people I know do not belong to the governing class, he answered. And I intend to be one of the governing class.
I mean to act up here on Albany on all questions as nearly as possible as I think Father would have done. I thoroughly believe in the Republican Party when it acts up to its principles. But if I can prevent it, I shall never let party zeal obscure my sense of right and decency.
I have never known a man who gave one a greater sense of security. I never heard him say that there was a problem that he thought it was impossible for human beings to solve. I never knew him to face life or any problem that came up with fear.
Franklin Roosevelt was essentially a lonely man. No one was allowed to know all that was going on within what 1-8 called his thickly forested interior.
That becomes a habit in your life, to not reveal yourself to others as if there's a scar that you're afraid that someone else will see. You always have to be the one that's up. You always have to be the one that's doing well. And it means that you're not in touch, in a certain sense, with some of those emotions within yourself. It makes it harder for you, but it also makes you more mysterious, more magical, perhaps, to the outside world.
Ideology did not interest him. Once asked for his philosophy, he said he was a Christian and a Democrat, and that was all. He was steeped in tradition and conservative by instinct, but he was also utterly unafraid of experimentation. It is common sense to take a method and try it, he said. If it fails, admit it frankly and try another. But above all, try something. I want to be a preaching president, FDR said, like my cousin Theodore. And he believed, just as Theodore Roosevelt had believed, that the presidency was preeminently a place of moral leadership.
Tell them I'm on top of it.
I mean more than that.
You are well aware that I do not drop the ball on things like this, Remy.
Promises, Franklin. Secretary of State, Argentina, the offshore drilling contract.
Talk to me when I've solved the problem. Don't waste my time when I'm working on solving it.
There's billions on the line. You can't not call me back, and I can't not show up.
Fine. Thank you for your diligence.
Eight figures to you in the DCCC. $6 million to build that library of yours in your name.
I know.
Don't make them throw money at your challenger next cycle.
You've made your point.
Have I? I hope so.
Such a waste of talent. He chose money over power. In this town, a mistake nearly everyone makes. Money is the McMansion in Sarasota that starts falling apart after 10 years. Power is the old stone building that stands for centuries. I cannot respect someone who doesn't see the difference.
I hope you haven't waited long.
It's peaceful here. I didn't mind.
Peaceful now? 15,000 men died in these woods. My grandfather's grandfather died where we're standing.
My grandfather was killed in the revolution.
So I've heard.
Do you fear death, Mr. Vice President?
No more or less than any man.
It motivates me to experience everything, accomplish all I can before it all vanishes.
I think you and I are similar in that regard.
Then why are we working at cross purposes?
Now, what you mean is, why am I not submitting to you and Mr. Tusk?
You're sabotaging the negotiations.
And you're using them for your own personal ends.
Wrong. It's taken me 7 years to convince the Standing Committee that this was the right course of action.
A course of action that will earn you and Tusk billions.
Why did you want this meeting? Just to attack me?
To send a message to Raymond. The President of the United States and I are not his puppets. Now you tell him that.
Fine. The bridge deal is dead. There will be no saving it.
Stick a knife through its heart and put an apple in its mouth. I won't shed a tear.
Your president will ascribe the failure to you.
I'll take the risk.
Think strategically, Mr. Vice President. You're setting us on a very dangerous course.
Do you know how Grant defeated Lee? He had more men. That's all. And he was willing to let them die. It was butchery, not strategy, which won the war.
Mr. Tusk and I have great resources at our disposal.
Add up all your billions together and you get the GDP of Slovakia. I have the federal government of the United States of America to intimidate me. The most that you can buy is influence, but I wield constitutional authority.
The strongest army doesn't always win. Mao started out with only a few thousand men. They took over half a continent.
Mao is dead, and so is his China.
But I'm not.
Not yet.
Don't forget, your ancestor fought for the losing side. There is no sacred ground for the conquered.
Such great writing. I love the description of FDR having a thickly forested interior. You know, with Frank, he can break the fourth wall and talk to us and we understand what he's thinking. Or how do you portray someone who is so on all the time, who never shows his true self?
This is a good thing for Jeff to start with, but this was one of the great, things that we wrestled with as filmmakers, but he's been doing it for decades.
I got interested in FDR, when I was a kid, but when I was a grown-up and thinking of something to write about, I listened to tapes of FDR, secret tapes that were made in the Oval Office. They were made to record, not for nefarious purposes, but to record press conferences, and he would forget to turn the machine on and off. It was only for a few months. But what I was, I'd always been interested in him, but what I was dazzled by was he is the same man sitting behind his desk telling his secretary what a nice dress she's wearing, as he is when he's talking to A. Philip Randolph of the Railroad Porters Union or the Secretary of War. He's this incredible act all the time. And who was behind that act began, I've spent my life trying to figure that out. I have never figured it out. And he is a mystery wrapped in a mystery wrapped in a mystery. And that's what makes him so fascinating to me. And he would, I love this, he would never have turned to the camera and explained anything he was thinking, ever, ever, ever.
No, but I think that opacity and that deviousness that protected the opacity was the challenge from all, as Stephen Vincent Benet said, of the picklocks of biographers that we tried to do that. And I think what aids us in this are the photographs that give something, the voice, and particularly the personal voice, and as you know better than anyone else, we've been aided in the last couple of decades by having the extraordinary correspondence between him and his distant cousin, Daisy Sukley, who becomes a major player in this story because she opens him up from being sort of one-dimensional flat portrait that he was more than happy to have the world see, and Eleanor was more than happy to promote, as that quote about, I have never seen him do anything like that. And that Daisy at least gives him another dimension that seemed to me just, I felt as if the curtain had been pulled back a little bit.
A little,
and for moments, you saw the pain of the braces, you saw the discomfort, you saw a sense of humor that wasn't just that life of the party sense of humor and something else. And that, I mean, it reminds you in a very humiliating way that all biography, all history is a kind of failure, because the person closest to us, even in life, has an aspect that remains inscrutable, and our job is to take someone who lived a century or half a century ago and try to divine something from them. It's a little bit easier than the fiction writers who can...
Yeah, because we have to plant the forest.
Right.
And then water it so that it can grow thickly. But one of the advantages, and you know, you're absolutely right, in life people don't turn and speak to phantom millions of people. I mean, people do. In New York, they do it a lot.
Yes.
You usually try to, you walk to the other side of the street. Do you want to get that? It might be... I think that Frank Underwood, if you didn't have the direct address, actually, would be very similar to SCR in that he would, it is all an act, what he presents the outside world. It is thickly and forested. And what the direct address allows us to do is something that we could never do with FDR, which is take a walk through the woods, literally, in that scene. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, if Frank Underwood was someone who I knew the entire topography of that forest, I would have zero interest in spending, every day of my life trying to think about it and figuring it out.
That's what Dory says, it's the mystery.
Yeah, you know, so, I mean, it's a weird sort of thing where, I mean, obviously he doesn't exist, I think. And we are creating him, but it doesn't feel like we're creating him, it feels like we're discovering him.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't think I will ever fully know who Frank Underwood is. And same goes for Claire, you know. But, you know, this whole little tidbit started on ideology, I think. And I can't get enough of that quote, you know, when people sort of look at Frank Underwood and say he has no ethics, he has no moral center, he has no code. You know, I can now say, have you seen Ken Burns and Jeff Ward's PBS documentary on the Roosevelts? Because FDR, you know, had no ideology, wasn't interested in it. He was a Democrat and a Christian at most, right? And to me, that's a fascinating thing about the most successful politicians, mm-hmm. Those that hold office or those that are married to them, which is the ability to be chameleons, the ability to be facile, the ability to change their minds, the ability to not get too entrenched in any one idea, because I think that ideology in its purest sense is a form of cowardice, because if you are intransigent, then you do not have the ability to empathize, right, intellectually, emotionally, psychologically, socioeconomically, you name it. You don't have the ability to literally step into someone else's shoes and see it from their perspective and meet them somewhere in the middle, which is what democracy is really supposed to be. And I think imagination is its own form of courage, and ideology is a veiled form of cowardice, because you don't have to make any choices when you have a strict code. Everything is prescribed for you. You draw a line in the sand, and no one moves. Mm-hmm. And what you see with someone like FDR, what you see with Eleanor and Teddy time and time again, is the ability to quite easily step over that line. Now, where they step to might be a very difficult place, and sometimes it's quicksand, and they fail, and they struggle, and they're not always right, but they're open. And it's a form of freedom.
But they're going somewhere.
They're moving.
All of those people that you named are people who really had ideas they wanted to make real. I'm not yet convinced that Frank does. I look forward to the coming season.
I like there's a
I plan to vote for him, but I'm wary.
There's a line in the documentary about FDR's image of the presidency was himself in it.
Yes.
And I thought that seems like something
that is
Frank
true. That's a true of Francis Underwood, and it's true of Theodore Roosevelt. Yep. And I think that within Eleanor, and hers is a more complex situation because she's a woman in an era in which we didn't consider the fact, as we do today, that a woman could be president. But Louis Hall had told her that he wanted not only to make Franklin president, but he wanted to make her. And the combination of this oppressive childhood Franklin's infidelity sort of gave her the fuel to move out and become the Eleanor Roosevelt that we want. And I'm sure behind a lot of that activity is, was Louis Howe right? You know, could I be this? Could it be the idea of the presidency? Is me a woman in it? I think all of them are compelled by that kind of dream. I mean, certainly this is what animates the first two seasons of your extraordinary show. And this is, it, you know, they have our Roosevelts, these very, I think, legitimate, altruistic ideas about making things better. They're to the manor born. They could have spent their whole life in idle pursuits, and they chose not to, and they didn't sort of apply the easy money to a situation and buy results as much as they participated in it and got themselves messy in the politics with that non-rigid ideological way. But they also, in the course of it, are betrayed and are, you know, human beings that have that kind of same avarice, the same plotting, the same kind of Machiavellian things that we attribute in the Underwoods as being the only thing that they are. But I also see in Frances and Claire also these rays and access to a kind of a purity and a kind of sincerity and a desire to do something good, even in all of the seeming outward manipulation.
I mean, to me, the most fascinating thing about, well, no, there's many fascinating things, but one of the most fascinating things about FDR and Teddy, and you can lump, I think, Lincoln in with this, is a total, utter disregard for the Constitution.
Yeah.
You know? they didn't care. I really don't think they honestly cared. I might be wrong. You guys know better than me. I don't think they cared that much about the Constitution. If anything, they saw it as a nuisance. I mean, it can be a useful document at times. At other times, it's a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
You know, if you're Lincoln, you go, I don't want this city to be in the South. Let's just dissolve the legislatures of Maryland and Kentucky. You know? Yeah. Done. You know? If you're FDR, let's just, the court isn't what I want it to be. Let's double the size of it and put my people in. Because what's happening is this document is getting in the way of something far bigger, a vision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is when it becomes an impediment to the imagination, you know, and when someone says, I think all these people thrived on, you can't do that,
right, exactly.
Or no one's ever done that.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, now I really am interested if I'm FDR. I'm like, I can't? Watch me.
Yeah.
You know, and part of that is ego. You know, part of that is cheating death or being the master of your own universe while you're here. And it can be an incredibly positive force. It can be an incredibly destructive force. I mean, FDR was up against some people that shared that same sentiment on the other side of the pond. Their names were Mussolini and Hitler. And in many ways, they were similar.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think, and this goes back to that sort of notion of voluntary insanity. But I think, you know, I respect anyone who thrives on the words you can't and no one has and you mustn't and wants to do the opposite. Because the great things that have ever happened in art, in politics, in you know, in your own lives were probably the result of a transgression.
Do you have a complicated backstory for your characters?
I was just going to ask that question.
You know, because when you think about what you just described, Beau, is in the Roosevelts, what's so central is this idea of having each of them these very serious wounds, you know, real significant adversity that they're able to escape the specific gravity of and become who they are, in fact, because of these painful things, the childhood asthma and sickliness and the overwhelming tragedy of Theodore's early life and Eleanor, it shouldn't have survived childhood. And Franklin has this rather charming and ambitious life interrupted by infantile paralysis at age 39. And yet from each of these moments of real trauma, something happens that creates who they are.
Yeah, I mean, I will only talk about what people have seen and not what they might see. But some of the things we know about Frank Underwood is that he comes from a tiny little town called Gaffney in South Carolina. He didn't have 2 cents to rub together. And that, you know, he, by hook or by crook, made his way to a military academy and on to Harvard and so on and so forth. I mean, I'm looking for the acts of transgression, of rebellion, not necessarily wounds that you could reverse engineer in a Freudian way, like because of X you get to Y. But I think for anyone who comes from a tiny little town that has almost zero opportunity in it, you know, whose father is a failure, who is working on a peach farm that is not profitable, and is really, you know, the real estate of dead endness. The transgression is even just to get out, just to say I'm capable of escape. Mm-hmm. And if you look at Claire Underwood, we know she came from privilege. She came from, you know, a family of high stature in Texas. We've seen those photos of her with her horse. And if you think about her, the most rebellious thing she could have done was to say, I'm going to marry this law student from South Carolina, mm-hmm. from this tiny little town who comes from nothing. He wants to run for state senate. You know, and she said to us in the first season what really enamored her in terms of Frank was, she's saying this, by the way, to a man who's dying of cancer on his deathbed while she's also servicing him in an interesting way. So you won't see that in the documentary. But she goes, you know, he didn't promise me happiness. He said I would never be bored. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, and he didn't put me on a pedestal. He saw me for what I am. And I think that the thrill of that, you know, the thrill of being significant, not just seen, and doing it with this guy who said, I can't give you happiness, and who cares, who wants happiness, must have been incredibly devious of her to hitch herself to that person. You know, and look, I mean, there will be things that you learn in mm-hmm. seasons to come, and we're always careful not to give too much away and not to explain one's character identity, because I don't know what makes someone a rebel, what makes someone a transgressor. You know, I've said this in a previous talk we did. Right. Napoleon grew up on the island of Corsica. There were dozens and dozens of other boys on Corsica who grew up pretty much the same set of circumstances sure. he did. And one of them left and conquered most of Europe. And the rest never left the island. What is it? Why?
And you'll never
we'll
know.
We'll never know.
No.
You know, it's like people who say LBJ, the reason that he thirsted for power so much because the Johnson family was in disgrace. There in Texas and poor. And no, I mean, if you talk to people who knew him at the time, there was a time when his father was pretty highly regarded, right, exactly. and they were well-to-do, and they say he was a shit even then. You know, he still wanted everything and to, you know, and to have the biggest plate at the table and you know, be the loudest person on the playground. And so I don't know what that thing is and why people right. have it, but I think you can find lots of things that are symptomatic.
That's right.
And that amplify it.
Yeah, you're chasing sort of symptoms.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned Claire, because that gets us to something that these political families obviously have in common, and that is complicated marriages.
Which is, of course, redundant.
Right. That's true. Let's take a look at these power couples.
He set lofty goals for himself and his country and pursued them with a cheerful deviousness that sometimes appalled his allies and often disappointed his wife.
He might have been happier with a wife who was completely uncritical. That I was never able to be, and he had to find it in other people. Nevertheless, I think I sometimes acted as a spur, even though the spurring was not always wanted or welcome. I was one of those who served his purposes.
The Roosevelts would become perhaps the most admired and the most reviled couple ever to occupy the White House. Franklin would be denounced as a dictator, a socialist, a traitor to his class. Eleanor was dismissed as naive, meddling, dangerously radical.
They needed each other too. One was strong where the other was weak. FDR was not as idealistic as Eleanor Roosevelt. Eleanor Roosevelt was not as good a politician as Franklin Roosevelt. Together, they represented both the better angels of our nature and a sense of how to get it done. How to let those angels actually have some authority and run things.
Any president gets lied to by all the yes men around him. They all need to go around that chain of command and find out what's really going on the ground. She was a tremendous asset to him in telling him what was working, not working in the New Deal. She would fill the inbox next to his bed, and he would then say to his cabinet, "My missus tells me WPA is not working too well in Texas."
The Roosevelt marriage was a partnership in which each played a very important part. Each admired the other. Each wanted very much the approval of the other. That was true throughout their lives together, even when they were mad at each other. They lived very separate lives. Even when they were in the White House, they were very separate lives. And she took a sort of cold view of his fame and the kind of popularity he had. She knew who he was, and he wasn't quite who they thought he was. And he sought her approval, but he had all sorts of practical political decisions that he felt he had to make, some of which she disapproved of. And it bothered him when she didn't like it.
You didn't call. You didn't call me, Francis. 9 hours. You don't not call me. Not when it's this big.
You're right.
When have we ever avoided each other?
I wanted the solution first.
Do you have one?
Not yet.
This affects me too, Francis. And it's not the money I'm upset about. It's that we do things together. When you don't involve me, we're in free fall.
I should have called you, and I didn't.
What happened?
She says they need to keep me in Congress.
Linda said that?
Walker wasn't even there. That's what really gets me. He didn't have the courage to look me in the eye.
I knew you shouldn't trust that woman.
I didn't. I don't. I don't trust anyone.
Then how could you not see this coming?
I never thought they were capable.
You don't usually underestimate people, Francis.
I know. Hubris. Ambition.
You should be angry.
I'm livid.
Then where is that? I don't see it.
What do you want me to do? Scream and yell? Throw a tantrum?
I want more than I'm seeing. You're better than this, Francis.
Well, I'm sorry, Claire. I am sorry.
No, that I won't accept.
What?
Apologies. My husband doesn't apologize, even to me.
Other people know, Claire. This could become a story about us, and that's something you do not recover from.
Who?
That's something that follows you for life.
Who knows?
Zoe.
I thought you said she could be trusted.
What about our trust?
You can't control her, can you, Francis?
She wouldn't have been a problem if you hadn't lied.
No, she wouldn't have been a problem if you hadn't dropped your pants. And you come in here to my office and berate me when you're the one who's exposed us?
Don't you try to turn this around on me.
I've hired half of my staff for us. I have turned down donations for us. I drafted Peter's bill for us. I diverted time and energy away from my goals for us.
Okay, I don't want to have to say this, but maybe you need to hear it. CWI is important, yes. But it doesn't come close to what we're trying to accomplish. You must see that. I'm just being honest.
And be honest about how you've been using me just like you use everybody else. That was never part of the bargain.
Is it the hot flashes?
Get out.
I'll see you back at the house. You know, I cannot guarantee that all of this is going to succeed.
Oh, it's not that.
You can tell me or I can keep guessing.
You'll roll your eyes.
How do you?
I was thinking about when one of us dies, whether it's you first or
me. Well, if it is me, and I'm sure it will be, you won't be alone for long.
No, I mean, what will we leave behind?
We've accomplished a great deal, and I intend for us to accomplish a lot more.
But for whom?
For each other.
But if we're not... I'm being silly.
People love to speculate of the inspiration for that marriage in House of Cards. Did you look at the Roosevelts when you were writing this relationship?
No, honestly, not as a template, not as like, hey, you know, this is how they did it, and what can we steal? I had a maybe slightly better than average knowledge of the Roosevelts, but we were looking at so many different people and so
Bill
many
and
different
Hillary?
What's that?
Bill and Hillary?
Not just political couples, you know. I mean really all sorts of different unions, you know, and not all of them marriages. There's a kind of mojo to that marriage that I try not to overanalyze too much, or I'm always discovering new things about it, and its rules and dynamics are constantly shifting, and it's very much become its own. So I feel like it's naturally leading us where it needs to go. I think that you can compare it to lots of real life unions, and you might find parallels, but it's not based on any one marriage. I don't think any marriage. I think every marriage is unique.
Right.
Yeah, I don't think, you know, it's like, what's the line that starts Anna Karenina? You know, all happy families are like, all unhappy families are unhappy in their own way. I think all happy marriages are happy in their own way, and all unhappy marriages are unhappy in their own way. I'm not going to tell that story, but... I don't think really anyone knows what a marriage is except the two people in it.
Yes.
Honestly. And they're not sure.
And they're not sure completely. No, I agree with that wholeheartedly. And I think that we live in a media culture where we have, we think in the advertising that's before us, guides to what it should be like, and the television shows of how people should get along, what the sex is like, and everything is completely unique to that relationship. And there are no rules and there's no expectation. There is just what it is. And I think that's one of the hardest things that we do, not just in fiction, but in fact, to just let the thing be what it is. We always want to superimpose an expectation on Franklin and Eleanor to be a certain way. Well, then if you're not this way, then you must be this way. And therefore, we travel down another rabbit hole that has a kind of equal fraudulence to the last one we were in, you know?
Yeah. I think there's a lot of easy writing about historical figures just along those lines, in which you, first of all, you work on a modern template and you put it on them. Lives were different then. Human beings were the same, but lives were different. And there's a lot of just vulgar stuff now, and people can't seem to get enough of it, and it doesn't seem to matter if anybody's looked anything up, or a gentleman just died who wrote, gentleman I use loosely, who wrote books about the Kennedys and various other people, and it's quite clear he made up two-thirds of it, and the country believes the stuff, you know? It's really appalling. This is, you know, it's great to be able to make it up, but if you're pretending you're not making it up, it's pretty bad.
I was waiting for a train yesterday and surveying a bookshop, and I was stunned in the nonfiction how much of the nonfiction was fiction.
You know, bet.
LBJ is the murderer with mugshots.
I was in the same railroad station.
We should ride together next time. Not the murderer of JFK, Sorry.
Those sell better than the real stuff, too, sometimes.
In that same first conversation I had with Fincher, I said, not only do I want this to be a story about a marriage, I want to do something that I thought was radical, which is tell the story of a successful marriage. Right. And because so many movies and TV shows and plays and books you've read, much of 20th century art making is about how marriages fail. And I thought it would be interesting to explore a marriage that works completely, but completely on its own terms. Right. And they feel the same way about vows that maybe FDR and Teddy and Abe felt about the Constitution. If it's an impediment,
it's elastic.
I think that a lot of people think, if they're having relationships outside of their own, that therefore it's a bad marriage, an unhealthy marriage. Something must be wrong. And they make an argument for that not being the case. I think that a lot of people who do follow the rules find themselves miserable and cause each other far more pain because, again, they're rigid in their thinking about what a union is. So they have found out what a union is for them. And that's why I think that FDR and Eleanor, I'd say that's a very successful marriage.
It's a triumphant marriage.
Even though, he cheated on her, she, in a way, cast him out emotionally. They very often lived in different houses. A lot of people would look at that and be like, what a terrible marriage. And yet, neither one of them would have been who they were without each other, and they knew that, and they found a way.
Yes,
exactly right. I completely agree.
There's one element of their marriage that I want to ask about that's not in the clip, and that is the overbearing mother-in-law.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I am here, and I think Jeff would back me up, to defend Sarah Delano Roosevelt. She's got a bad rap. Let's just unpack it just briefly, if we could. She comes down to us as this dragon lady, the worst of all mother-in-laws. But let's remember what she also did positively. First of all, she instilled her only child with such extraordinary confidence and optimism that even in the face of the paralyzation that polio represented, he was still able to lift us up through the Depression and through the Second World War when he couldn't lift himself up without braces, without crutches, without the help of other human beings. That's an incredible testament to a strong-willed mother who loved him in exactly the same way she loved him when he was born to the day she died. She also inherited a daughter-in-law who had no modeling of parents on her own. Eleanor was orphaned by the age of 10. Her father had been a hopeless alcoholic and mentally ill. Her mother was this aloof beauty, hypochondriacal, who was disappointed in her looks and called her granny. She just had the worst childhood and had no modeling of parenting. And so when she has five kids who survive infancy, she had six, but there's 19 marriages among those five kids, you're dealing with someone, who's not imprinting. She's trying very, very hard to sort of keep this incredibly, at least on the outside, we would say dysfunctional family together, where there's infidelity, there's polio, there's political ambition, there's anger, there's distrust, there's betrayal, there's incredible love. And she's doing it. Of course she's going to be overbearing or seem overbearing to Eleanor. But I would just like to
she did bathe him until he was nine.
Whatever it was.
She did bathe him until he was nine.
She did.
Yeah.
She did. No, I think she's one of the great mothers in American history. And Mrs. Roosevelt, looking back, resented her. When she was young, she desperately needed that lady to help her. And she was very grateful. Her mother-in-law hired all the nannies and all the tutors and so on. I think neither Roosevelt was a very good parent. She didn't know how to do it. She said so. She wrote about it. And he was a very self-absorbed man who loved his kids to throw them around and then sort of leave them for the women to deal with. And then he got polio and he was away from home for 7 years trying to get back on his feet. And so they really had no, they had no real parents. And that old lady, whatever, however imperious she was their actual mother. I mean, she gave them what Eleanor Roosevelt could not give them, which was unconditional love, which is a cliche, but we all know what it means. Mrs. Roosevelt once said she thought love, it was wonderful to have love, but one should always earn it. Well, that's pretty tough if you're a parent. I mean, kids don't always earn your love. And she's a very great lady, but not I think, a very good mother.
There's a telling moment in the, what do you call them, episode last night, where shortly after they were married, she, Sarah, and FDR got their house, or, I mean, mm-hmm. apartments that had doors between them.
Yeah, two adjoining townhouses on East 65th
right.
Street, in which Sarah had built for them, had built, right. and had connections on three of the five floors, which means your mother-in-law is in your life.
Right, and then she and Franklin proceeded to decorate the whole thing and pick out the furniture and all that, and Eleanor felt, FDR found her weeping, right, because, and asked her what was wrong, and she said, this isn't my home. I had nothing to do with the choosing of this home, the decorating of it, so on and so forth, and he sort of said, you'll feel better soon, and walked away. But then, Sarah did build a summer home for them, which was miles away from her own, so that they could have a place to themselves. And Eleanor loved it and adored it and felt like it was her home. What that tells me about Sarah, and I mean, she was sort of buying her way out of a jam, but at least an understanding, and it must have been very hard for her, I think, to know that FDR and Eleanor with their children would be living in a separate house during the summer months, but an acknowledgement that of Eleanor's feelings.
Yes.
And it's, I mean, a very sort of, it's an architectural solution.
No, it is.
Right. Rather than,
And Franklin performs the same thing when he builds Valkill for her, so that she has a clubhouse that she can go with her friends and feel a kind of authority and independence, quite apart from the extraordinary domination of this, the mother and her husband.
Well,
that story is very famous because Mrs. Roosevelt told it in her autobiography about the houses. The funny thing is, two things. One is, those houses were not unusual. She was married in a house like that, which two generations of the same family had doors between them. And when she was an old lady, the only words you could say is she fell in love with her doctor, who was a wonderful man named Dr. David Gurevich. And he married a suitably aged woman, and they bought apartments together in the same house. And Mrs. Roosevelt there was no door between. And
you mean these, Eleanor now?
Yes, yes. Eleanor Roosevelt. And these newlyweds would find Mrs. Roosevelt in their bedroom in the morning to wish them a good morning.
We had a scene
she
like
wasn't
that
much
in
for
season two.
In the kitchen.
Sorry?
It wasn't a doctor, it was a Secret Service agent. We call it the threechum.
Yeah.
For those of you think about it for a second, threechum.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. That one usually gets a laugh.
I completely fail.
It is common sense to try a method, and if it fails,
try.
I was just the anecdote you were talking about. I love that Eleanor wasn't much for helping in the kitchen. She
was
like supposed to wash some lettuce, and she screwed up.
Edna Gurevich describes the one time that she was asked to just wash lettuce, and finally she came out to her husband David and said, "Please find an excuse to get Mrs. Roosevelt out of the kitchen. We're standing knee deep in water."
So we're leading into the midterm elections. There's such gridlock in Washington. People think that just can't get anything done, either party. You look at FDR's first 100 days, 15 bills, not including Social Security, the centerpiece of the New Deal. Let's take a look at how the Roosevelts and the Underwoods get things done.
In June, just as congressmen were preparing to leave town for the summer, Roosevelt seized back the initiative, calling upon them to enact five major pieces of legislation by autumn. In part to steal a little of what FDR called Huey's thunder, he proposed new taxes on the wealthiest Americans. He also wanted the Federal Reserve System strengthened and a new law to break up monopolistic holding companies. And in the interest of achieving for ordinary Americans something of the sense of security that had been his since boyhood, Roosevelt threw himself behind two bills, initially championed by the Democratic senator from New York, Robert F. Wagner. They would turn out to be two of the most momentous pieces of legislation in American history. The first, called the Wagner Act, created the National Labor Relations Board, and for the first time, provided a federal guarantee of labor's right to organize and bargain collectively. But it was the second, the Social Security Act, that would be the most far-reaching. It would provide old age insurance, paid for by taxes on employees and their employers. Share with the states responsibility for insuring the unemployed. And provide federal aid to the states to help care for dependent mothers and children, the handicapped and the blind.
Social Security represents a redefinition of the American social contract, of what we owe each other as a people. In old age, and should they be widowed, they deserved some help from the government. And for that reason, he considered it to be the centerpiece of the New Deal. He put it in through a regressive payroll tax, so that it couldn't be taken away. So, as he said, no damn politician can ever take this away. Like all great pieces of social legislation, you gotta start somewhere. And the bill just barely cleared committee. So he knew that if he did too much for the liberals, he was gonna blow the bill. If he did too much for the conservatives, then he'd lose his liberal support. And it was his political genius to know just how much the system could take. And people sometimes say nowadays, why can't we have a leader like FDR who just gets it done the way he wants it done? Nothing could be further from the truth. It was all compromise, playing people off each other, pushing the system a little here or there, putting the foot on the gas, then on the brake, back and forth. There's an artistry to politics. And Social Security wouldn't exist if he hadn't been a brilliant political artist.
It's not as progressive as I'd like.
You mean radical.
Raising retirement age to 67 makes entitlements solvent until 2055, and it saves us over $1 trillion without a single penny of taxpayer income.
68 would give us another $300 billion, and I'd like to eliminate early retirement.
Entirely?
Forget it!
What about 68 and 64?
I have a responsibility to my constituents. I promised I wouldn't waver when it came to
things. Are we really going to allow the Tea Party to determine fiscal
legislation? I've never been beholden to the Tea Party.
Oh, come on, Curtis. You wouldn't have won re-election if their PACs hadn't dumped $10 million into your campaign.
If their definition of budgetary conservatism happens to overlap with mine, that's a function of...
Curtis, this shows some goodwill. Can you stomach 68 and 64?
Effective immediately?
5 years from now.
Not interested.
Well, you know, we can't throw this on people without any warning. They need some time to digest.
I'm sorry. I just can't do it.
Okay. Meet with your staff, consult with your colleagues, I'll consult with mine, and let's talk tomorrow.
All right. I can agree to that.
But this is a good first step.
Avondale!
Here.
Excuse me, I do believe you're sitting in my chair.
Mr. Drury, what is the order of business?
We are in a quorum call, sir.
Then why aren't you calling the roll?
We are, sir, in a deliberate manner.
Let's speed it up.
Mr. Brown.
Here.
More expeditious than that.
Mr. Burr.
Here.
Ms. Cantwell.
Here.
Mr. Serini.
Check.
Thank you.
Cornwall.
Here.
Mr. Coulson.
Here.
Ms. Dowster.
They have a quorum. We don't have the numbers.
Out. Let's get all the people out.
Mr. Demerell. Mr. Darling. Yep. Mr.
Here.
Daswani.
Here.
Mr. Donner.
Faster.
Mr. Dobbin. Mr. Dwyer.
Here.
Aaron Hearn. Engel. Erickson.
Here.
Mr. Fell. Garrison. Gentry. Mr. Haas. Mr. Whitehouse.
Here.
Mr. Wicker. Mr. White. Mr. President. A quorum is not present.
The chair recognizes the minority leader, Mr. Erickson.
Mr. President, I move to direct the sergeant-at-arms to compel the attendance of absent senators that warrants for the arrests of all senators not sick nor excused be issued under the signature of the presiding officer.
The question is on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay.
Nay.
The ayes have it, and the motion is agreed to. The sergeant of arms is hereby instructed to compel the attendance of absent senators.
It feels good to be back in Congress.
That is such great writing, and I want anyone who says it's unrealistic to go back and watch FDR's move at the convention for the third term
exactly.
And trying to stack the Supreme Court.
And Byrd, actually, that happened. Senators were arrested and compelled to come. Yeah, but FDR did a lot crazier stuff than that.
Okay. Crazy stuff.
Yeah.
There is, as I said in the clip, a real artistry in this. Is that how you tried to sort of portray, both of you, the drama of legislation through this sort of artistry
of
politics?
Yes, I think this is it. I think that for us today, politics has a very dirty word, but politics is essentially mechanics. Politics is the way everything works. And so I think the politics in the Roosevelts, and I think Beau would agree, in House of Cards, is a politics between a man and a woman, between the individuals as well as the larger sense of it, of getting things done. And I think that in these clips, the most similar that I feel is in that scene, that the artistry almost is parallel in that regard.
Yeah, I love that notion of politics as an art, because a lot of people think, and you know, you hear about gridlock in Washington, it's like, well, these numbers don't add up, and those numbers don't, and this and that, and columns, and you know, accounts, and you know, your statistics are off, and this and that, and it has nothing. Has nothing to do with that. I mean, the artistry of politics has to do with in tiny, gradual, and oftentimes almost invisible ways, shifting someone's mindset just a little, and then shifting that person's mindset just a little, 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 just a little. And a lot of people look at the gap between here and here, and they go, "That is, there's no way to traverse that chasm." You know. But my dad, Stephen, I may fail here. My dad, when I was a little kid, I saw him at the dinner table one day making a wine glass sing. And I go, Dad, how do you do that? He goes, I'm going to show you. He dipped his finger in the wine. And then he started to do it. You hear that?
Yeah.
And then I say, well, how are you doing that? He goes, well, here's the trick. The trick is knowing that you can.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know? Before that, I had been trying to do it, and it hadn't been working, because I was like, do I need to hold my finger at a certain angle? Do I need to press at a certain pressure? Do I have enough water? Do I not have enough? But the moment he said, just know that you can do it, I sat there and I go, I'm going to make it sing. Mm-hmm. And I did. And I think that's actually the artistry of politics.
I agree.
Well, I mean, that's good parenting. But you're right, it could be very dry. You know, you look at the dramatization of LBJ and the Civil Rights Act and how you can make something that would seem, you know, on the surface as dry legislating into this incredibly
I find it riveting drama. Riveting. You brought up LBJ. You can think of his unbelievable, the treatment on Senator Green from Rhode Island. You think about what Mankiewicz and Gary Hart did in McGovern's campaign during the convention in 72. There are this is as dramatic of stuff as you can get, and I think that's what we're drawn to. We like it when it works. We like it when we're given a peek under the hood and we get to see, you know, what that engine's like. It's that incremental moving together.
There's a certain salesmanship too. I mean, I'm in show business, and I mean, you guys are too to a degree. You have to believe anything can be sexy. You know, I mean, you're looking at a guy who, for a good long while in season two, was like, "We're going to do a major story on patent reform." Because I think patent reform is fascinating, and I truly do. And I was like, I want the rest of America to think that patent reform is fascinating. And I'm like, if anyone's going to make it sexy, it's going to be Francis. But, you know, you can't always achieve miracles. And so we dispensed that story.
Can't you just pick them up?
But if you look, if you look at actually, if you went and read the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare. Mm-hmm. It went through hundreds and hundreds of pages. I mean, couldn't get drier, right? I mean, I've glanced at portions randomly. I'm like, it's not even in English, you know? And yet, somehow an idea has to be sold to America, or at least to your fellow politicians. And it's, how do I take this incredibly dry or complicated thing, and what is the story behind it? What is the idea? What is the thing that will connect? You know, I mean, that's how candidates win. You know, I think that FDR was able to communicate some pretty complicated legislation,
yes, he was.
Essentially with two ideas, like work and fairness.
Right.
Like, there's pride in work, and you see it in everything from the posters to the way he talks about it. And there's a certain, you know, everyone can get a fair shot, mm-hmm. you know, which may or may not be true, but he got people to believe it. Mm-hmm. And that is a way more powerful thing than the actual bills he passed, because those, over time, are going to be eroded or beefed up or changed or what have you. We see it happening now.
It's the idea of the thing. And
that can persist.
The thing that you and I talk about this all the time, that I think it's really important to restate, is that the same laws of storytelling apply to me as apply to you. You can make stuff up, but that doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter. We can't make stuff up, but whatever works in that storytelling, whatever works in that narrative structure, it is exactly the same, obeying the same laws of story. And I think that this set of clips really demonstrates how similar all of this is, because you didn't make that up completely out of whole cloth. The circumstances are made up, but it's drawn on real experience. Just as we take real factual experience and through editing and through selection and remembering, you know, honey, how is your day, doesn't begin, I back slowly down the driveway avoiding the garbage can at the curb, right. unless you're rear-ended, in which case that's exactly the way you tell it. But what we do is we edit, and all of it is taking that raw, chaotic experience and trying to superimpose some form, some story, some narrative of it, and make some sense, some existential sense. Keep the wolf from the door, the inevitability of our demise, and continue to enter ourselves with stories that are both true and also fanciful.
I had a playwriting teacher, and I thought my first playwriting teacher, who said, you know, because I started in the theater, you know, all play is the two most interesting hours in a person's life. You know, and I think the same can be said of incredibly complicated political agendas. Is, you know, what's the part that's going to grab you?
What's the story?
Yeah.
The other similarity, I think, is, and I think we've proved it with the kind of audience that we seem to have produced for this, people are perfectly able to understand very complicated human beings. They are in your show, and they are in our shows.
Yeah.
And whether it's history or fiction, people's lives are complicated. Everybody knows everyone else is complicated. They are themselves complicated. And it It's sad to me that it's so often simplified and broken down and made non-human. The people, most people on most television shows don't seem to me to be human people. And that's true of a lot of historical documentaries too, I'm sorry to say. People, it's so simplified and people won't get it, and you need villains and heroes. I think that's all nonsense.
We talked about this many times. John Keats wrote a letter about William Shakespeare, saying that William Shakespeare had this thing called negative capability, right, that he had this ability to keep in tension the conflicting aspects of a single person. Yeah. That it was the moralist in us that wishes to judge good or bad. It's that simplicity, that lowest common denominator, that suggests that we can superimpose an easy and facile judgment that turns people, complicated people, dimensional people, into kind of ciphers for one's sort of exposition. And that, in fact, all of us have, as you say, that complicated dimension. Certainly Frank and Claire have it within each
Absolutely.
Other. And even in just the three different scenes that marry their marriage yeah. together in different aspects, you can see that on display. It's there in Franklin and Eleanor. And it's so important to tolerate, as we must, in our own relationships. That's why I said complicated marriage is redundant. Because what we are doing is acknowledging in any sustained relationship that negative capability, the ability to keep in Hamlet or Macbeth or Lear or Iago the sense that we don't have to judge good or bad yet.
Right.
We can hold off and sustain it and sustain it and sustain the contradictions and the undertow and be enriched by that possibility of tolerating the sort of the neither and both mm-hmm. of everybody.
I think it's my turn to do the Whittenman quote.
Okay,
time,
okay, okay,
yeah.
Go ahead.
We switch off.
Yeah.
We've done this a couple
yeah,
times.
Yeah, everybody's but, dying. Which is really
for Whittman. But you guys probably know it. It's one of his most famous. It's in Song of Myself. Do I contradict myself? Very well, then, I contradict myself. I am large. I contain multitudes.
Yeah.
And I think the people that contain the most multitudes have the most contradictions.
Yes.
You know, and I want to draw a distinction. I wasn't, when I was talking about the simple, strong idea, you know, people are complex. Ideas are simple.
Yes.
Great ideas are very simple.
And that's why when we go back to the original discussion about ideology in the original thing, it seems, as you say, the prison of ideology. We can see how narrow that is. We can easily see it in the other country, in which we see that knee-jerk thing and we go, oh my God, thank goodness we're free of that.
That's
we're
right.
less willing to see it in ourselves or in those closest of us or those who apparently subscribe to our political philosophy. But the pragmatism that all of these people exhibit, the idea that you're just a Democrat and a Christian, and not necessarily in that order, and that's it, gives you the latitude to accomplish the things because you're not bound by the fraudulence and the simplicity of having this hard and fast ideology. Now, we're not saying that you're not principled or that you can't make a decision or go against something, but what you're saying is that you are not bound, hidebound, to a kind of ideology and orthodoxy that paralyzes you in a way that doesn't permit real progress.
There's a big difference between ideas and ideology.
Right.
Sure.
Ideas are big-minded and ideology is small-minded.
Right.
An idea would be, we must find a way. An idea is that work brings you dignity, would be an idea. You know, or everyone deserves a fair shot. Those are ideas. But then you can get into debate, is the best way to achieve that big government? Is it small government? Is it through a flat tax? Or is it through, a graduated tax? You know, you could say, I firmly believe that a small government is the best government. Or I firmly believe that a large government is better than, a federal government is better than, a small one. And you start to get into really quite arbitrary corners.
And look where we are today. I think the rigidity of our position, the sense that we can't even move out of these narrow structures are about that. You know, Jefferson was so much so much committed to the notion of small government and states' rights and individual freedom, and what does he do? He doubles the size of the country. You know, and Franklin Roosevelt spends the 1930s sort of spending and delighting in the hatred of the malefactors of great wealth. He welcomes the hatred of these economic royalists, as he calls them, and talks about, you know, a government that is that might make some errors in the spirit of charity, as opposed to one frozen in the ice of its own indifference. But then he's going to turn around the next decade and he's going to make these people richer than they've ever been, because he's going to ask them to out-manufacture everybody else in the world. And on September 2nd, 1945, he's dead, but as the surrender papers are being signed, more than 50% of all the manufacturing is happening in the United States. And he's created that. They've said, we can build 5,000 planes a month, and he says, no, you can build 50,000. They said, Mr. President, we cannot do that. He said, you will do that, and he did. And so all of a sudden, how does someone who is rigidly adhering to some ideology have that kind of flexibility to at one point spend a decade sort of terrorizing these people and then turning around and delivering them the largest profits that ultimately, and the unintended consequences, of course, are military-industrial.
Yeah, and mysteriously, they were ungrateful.
And they were ungrateful, yes.
Well, it's a difference. It's a difference between rigid ideology and and pragmatic optimism.
Right.
Right. And a lot of people think I get asked all the time, so you must have you write such a cynical show. You must have such a cynical view of politics. And I think that the show is deeply optimistic.
I agree completely.
And I do.
I agree completely.
I honestly do. That's not a joke. I mean, you're welcome to laugh.
No, I agree.
I'm not the arbiter of what is funny and what is not. what people do is they take cynicism and idealism and they put them on the same spectrum,
right?
Mm-hmm. And actually, that's wrong. You know, I know plenty of idealistic cynics or cynical idealists. Mm-hmm. Talk to anyone who works at an NGO here in D.C., right? And I know plenty of people who are optimistic and yet don't really have
anything to offer.
Yeah, some sort of grand vision or anything like that. Often they're optimistic about their own bank account. You know, but I think optimism is the same thing as making that glass sink. You know, it's saying where there is nothing, there can be something, and where there is stasis, there can be movement. And Frank Underwood, whatever his motivations are, whatever his reasons are, he's like, I'm not going to offer you happiness, but I will offer you something that's not boring. It's the same bargain he's made with his wife. I will offer you movement, forward motion. And it might be wrong. We might be going in a completely wrong direction. But you know what? At least it's somewhere. And nothing happens when you're going nowhere. To me, that's optimism. And I think that his expression of it, I mean, none of the world within House of Cards knows. We know because he turns and talks to us, Netflix subscribers or internet pirates.
the subset of internet pirates.
To them, they just see the expression of that optimism. They see an education bill passed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they see someone who is willing to work and earn that momentum. And I think that it is like a wish fulfillment of not necessarily the type of people that I want to see Washington populated, but the spirit.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I think that wonderful conversation at the window, sharing the cigarette with Claire when she asks about what's left, is a tremendous optimistic thing. I mean, it really shows that sort of underlying sense of what are we here for, the asking that essential existential question, what is this for? And in that space to ask the question is all the hopefulness that you're talking about and that optimism that I think it's embodying that. I agree with you completely.
I love this idea that's in the documentary of the presidency as a leather glove, and
yes,
and that FDR stretched it, that it takes the shape of whoever's hand it is. FDR stretched it, and I, spoiler, but Frank is president now. What shape will he make the glove of the presidency? What type of president will he be able to accomplish things? Will
There's
he
one way to
stretch
find
the
that.
Role? Come on,
I'm not gonna
give us something.
Look,
come on,
you don't want to ruin it for all of us. No, but it's a great thing that we've had to wrestle with, explore, and bang our head against the wall with is if you've been telling the story for 2 years of someone climbing Mount Everest, what's the story become when you're standing atop it?
You're not going to.
Well, there's a 13-hour answer coming your way.
I think
we're halfway through filming.
I think there's only one way to go. I'm just guessing, but there's only one way to go.
What's that movie about the Welsh town where the inhabitants? There's a hill that's near their village, and it's only like 930 feet. And in order for it to be a mountain, it has to be 1,000 feet. So the entire village starts carrying buckets of dirt to the top of this hill to add another 70 feet to it so that they can have a mountain. I like that sort of story.
Oh. Yeah.
Rather than the one that you're suggesting. But who knows?
Who knows? Who knows?
So I probably speak for a lot of women in the audience in that love these compliments. Did you want to tell us how Frank is as president? Or?
Well, no. I was considering, I was like, Pope, he is not Pope yet. although the Pope is named Francis.
Yes.
Coincidence?
I don't think so.
I was in a cab going over the Brooklyn Bridge when they announced on the radio that he had chosen the name Francis I, and I laughed my ass off. And the cab driver had no idea why. And it wasn't even worth trying to explain to him.
Well, I probably speak for a lot of the women in the audience in that I love the complicated women and Claire and Eleanor in both of these series. And not only are they with their husbands out of this interesting relationship, but they also recognize it as a shrewd way to accomplish their own goals.
Yes.
So let's take a look at that.
Gentlemen, thank you for coming.
Is the vice president attending?
No, he's not. He's out of town. I just decided to use his office because it's a bit bigger than mine. Please, sit. I know this isn't the first conversation you've had about sexual assault.
We've had a very open dialogue with the Congresswoman for quite some time.
Open is one way to put it. I think the Joint Chiefs have tolerated my concerns.
To be fair, we've been quite responsive. Over the past 2 years
The Congresswoman has expressed her frustration to me that there's still room for improvement.
Mrs. Underwood, if I may.
Please.
This is an issue we've grappled with seriously. Increased education and prevention measures, restructuring the reporting process, insulating courts martial from abuse of power.
It's still not enough.
Civilian jurisdiction is not gonna happen. We're all aware that's what the Congresswoman would prefer, but we won't allow our change.
Am I late? It's my fault. The meeting got pushed up. I meant to email you. I'm very sorry.
That's fine. Please, sit.
We didn't know you'd be attending, Mrs. Walker.
I'm sorry for interrupting. Continue.
As I was saying, putting sexual assault cases entirely in the hands of civilian courts fundamentally erodes the military's ability to self-discipline.
What about civilian oversight instead of civilian courts?
That's a slippery slope.
There were those who said the same of racial integration.
Integration didn't change the core operational nature.
But it did prove that the military could shape its own evolution.
Absolutely. But in this case, civilian oversight is not the answer.
My husband is a civilian who oversees the military. Are you suggesting that civilians can offer no guidance in matters like this?
Forgive me, Mrs. Walker. I didn't mean to suggest that at all.
Then maybe you should listen to the civilian sitting across from you.
Yes, ma'am.
This is from your own sexual assault prevention literature. And in it, it says, in some cases, it may be advisable to submit than to resist. I think it's quite clear that there's still room for improvement.
She was unanimously elected chair of a committee to draw up a Universal Declaration of Human Rights. History's first attempt at laying out the principles under which all nations should behave toward their own citizens as well as toward one another. It would not be easy. Her committee included Christians, Jews, Muslims, atheists, the representatives of democracies and dictatorships, colonial powers and once colonized peoples. and she had to deal with the State Department constantly worried she would promise too much. She was as tough as she was tactful, and drove her fellow delegates so hard that one felt called upon to remind her that they had human rights too. If they wanted shorter days, Theodore Roosevelt's favorite niece answered, they should make shorter speeches. Thanks largely to what one admirer called her distinctive blend of naivete and cunning, they fell into line, one by one.
This Universal Declaration of Human Rights may well become the international Magna Carta of all men everywhere. Man must have freedom in which to develop his full stature and through common effort to raise the level of human dignity.
New Zealand? Yes. United Kingdom? Yes.
At 3 a.m. on December 10th, 1948, the declaration was adopted without a single dissenting vote.
Yes.
Afterwards, the entire General Assembly did something it had never done before and has never done since. It rose to give a standing ovation to a single delegate. All her life, Eleanor Roosevelt said she'd wanted to take on a job and see it through to a conclusion. She had done it, and she had triumphed.
Eleanor.
Yeah, she's great. You know, Jeff had said this originally. He says it in the film that she's just a miracle of the human spirit for escaping that horrible childhood. But she is, with the exception of Prohibition, which you could give her a pass because her father was an alcoholic and she was surrounded by alcoholics, she was right on everything. And she saw all the coming issues of the day, stuff that we're still only beginning to even deal with, having to do with poverty and race and women and children and health and immigration and labor and all of the stuff that is there. She already got it. In the 1930s, she got it. Maybe even before she had it. And we had somebody once described Theodore Roosevelt as having distance in his eyes, that he could see sort of around the horizon or into the future. I think all three Roosevelts had it, but no one had it more than Eleanor Roosevelt. And you know, I think it's that cunning and naivete is really absolutely it. There's something incredibly guileless about her and just unrelenting.
But she was a tough cookie.
Yeah.
That's the other side. She was this gracious, wonderful lady, but it's the sort of thing that Beau's been talking about. When in the 50s, Franklin Roosevelt and Theodore Roosevelt had fought Tammany Hall all their lives, and FDR actually had to make his peace with Tammany to get on in New York politics. Mrs. Roosevelt never approved of Tammany, and Carmine DiSapio, who was head of Tammany Hall, she thought anyway, had denied the nomination for governor to her son Franklin. She said, I'm going to get him. She spent 7 years campaigning against him, and she drove him from office, and she did it. She, for one thing, she was quite ill, but she went around on sound trucks making speeches, holding a mic and holding on with one hand. And she also got on the radio and spoke in Italian to Italian voters. And then when she got off, she said, he doesn't speak Italian, and I do. And when she beat him, she just said to Edna Gurevich, our friend, she said, I said I would beat him, and I beat him. And she was steely, in addition to being all the other wonderful things she is. The mix of naivete and cunning is a really good phrase for her. She was an amazing, amazing human being.
There's a thing in tonight's episode which is so chilling with regard to a tragedy that happens in World War I that she says that you're just sort of taken aback, that you sort of expect it now from Claire. But when you hear it from Eleanor Roosevelt, or at least that sort of superficial conventional wisdom that comes down to us that is the shorthand for her, it seems surprising. But in the DiSapio thing, and then in response to a photograph that filtered from the front in World War One. It's just chilling.
She also was tireless. I'd tell this quickly. When I was 11 years old, I was very interested in the Roosevelts. And as a solemn 11-year-old, I wrote her a letter because I had read a book about FDR, and it bothered me that he had run for a third term. God knows why it bothered me, but it did. A week later, I got a handwritten letter from Eleanor Roosevelt, who I now know was staying up till 3 in the morning doing her correspondence, in part because if she weren't working, terrible depression would descend on her. But still, to have answered my letter, I'm still grateful. She's a remarkable woman.
What did it say, Jeff?
I had explained that my husband for a time did not know whether he would run, but the situation overseas made him feel that he should,
So this was
the official.
Thank
the
you
official.
For your inquiry.
No, it was a real letter.
Hope you're enjoying the summer.
No.
This was like a reason.
No, it was a real letter.
Let me triangulate from that. I was in Dallas as part of, exposing people to the thing, and I met a grandson of Eleanor, and when he was married, he traveled to New York for his honeymoon, and they stayed with her. And every night, on their honeymoon, she tucked them into bed, expecting them to be there at breakfast the next morning at 7. But the way the hotel suite was configured, her apartment in this hotel where she was, they could see through an air shaft that she was up until 3 a.m. responding to your letter, doing that, and then was a little bit perturbed when they weren't there, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, at 7 a.m. For the breakfast on the honeymoon that she had
prescribed.
It takes one to know one, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, I love that she had an all-female press corps in the White House.
This is the great thing. This is the first lady to have any kind of press conferences. And because women reporters were barred from the president's press conferences, mm-hmm. she barred men from hers. Mm-hmm. And
But you've talked about this, how she fundamentally changed the role of the first lady. And so, Beau, talk about how Claire may be as a first lady. How is she going to approach the role? You like that?
No one's tried that one. She's a reporter. It's a really good thing.
This was all orchestrated so Amy could get her scoop.
Some third season scoop.
Claire,
I don't picture her being the baking cookies type.
Well, it's interesting when I first started. I talked a big game to Fincher, saying, I want to do it about a marriage, right? And yet, if you look at the BBC version, on which ours is, I wouldn't even say really based, we sort of steal a few things here and there, the wife of Francis Urquhart is a tertiary character. She's not really around all that much. So this was going to require creating a character from scratch. And when I look back, I haven't looked at it in a long time, look back on my very first draft, episode 1, season 1. Claire was doing things like going to her book club, mm-hmm. and there was some dispute over the wine at this book club, and she made, in that scene that you saw tonight, where she goes, my husband doesn't apologize even to me. There was some lame joke where she's like pouring him a drink and saying, isn't it better, puts the glass on top of the liquor cabinet, goes, isn't it better to be on top of the cabinet than inside it? And I just want to puke in my mouth when I think about what I wrote, And I knew it wasn't there. There was no character. This was it's 2 grades above arm candy. It was a socialite who was being given busy work and a few clever lines. Mm-hmm. That does not a character make, or at least not a compelling one. So I was motivated largely because Eric Roth, who's one of the producers on the show and worked with Robin Wright on Forrest Gump, which he wrote, said, here's an idea. I think it should be Robin Wright to play the wife. And, I was like, Princess Bride and Jenny from Forrest Gump, I wasn't as familiar with her work. And David was working with her on Dragon Tattoo at the time and said, that's a brilliant idea, Eric. It's absolutely who it should be. Before I knew it, I was getting on the phone with Robin Wright and had this script, which I know she had read, and she couldn't possibly have read this character and thought that there was anything meaningful to do. And I had to convince her that we were going to do something extraordinary with this character, and I wasn't quite sure what yet. Talk about politics, right? And but largely because she believed in Eric and David, and she'd liked the rest of the script, she was willing to take a leap of faith, which put a huge amount of responsibility on my shoulders, because within 5 minutes of talking to Robin, I knew I was dealing with an extraordinary person. Just an open, raw, playful, smart human being that was going to suffer no fools. And I started over. I tossed everything clear out, and I had one simple rule as I went back into it, was that she needs to be someone absolutely and completely formidable, and Francis has to have gotten the better end of the deal. Mm-hmm. Like, that he needs to constantly be aspiring to get her approval.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, much the same way, yeah, I think Franklin didn't give a crap about anyone else on the planet. But if Eleanor goes, if he goes, hey, look what I did today, and she's like, huh, suddenly he's like, I could have done more.
Yeah.
You know? And that led through a lot of different iterations and rewriting that scene. My husband doesn't apologize, even to me. And when I finally got to that line, I'm like, okay, now I have the kernel. You know, and that used to be three scenes and about 12 pages of script. And as I went through it with Robin, she's like, I don't think we need this scene. And I was like, really? But that's the one. And she's like, no, we don't even need to talk about, I don't think they would talk about the nitty gritty of like how he's going to do his plan. She's not interested in the plan. She's interested in him actually accomplishing what he wants to accomplish, not how he does it. Okay. And then she's like, in this scene, I don't know, do we need this line? Do we need that line? Do we need this line? And I'm go, well, I don't know. It's a lot of stuff we're taking out, Robin. I think, don't you want to say something? And she's like, let me act it. You know? And so it took out a bunch of stuff. And what I learned from Robin was the power of giving an act, what can happen when you give an actor less, if you put all the ingredients together, like on the table, you know, and say, but really we only need these three, you know, and you throw in the pot and you let them do the simmering, then you can start to achieve and approach something way more powerful than anything you can write, and something incredibly enigmatic and mysterious, which I have to give her almost all of the credit for, because she really created a role that wasn't there before. There's an alarm telling us that we're over on our time, but we don't care about that, right? So, but look, I mean, the final thing I'll say about it, I mean, I could go on and on talking about Claire, not really quite knowing what to say, because there's like a sort of voodoo at work.
That's
you know?
Why she's so and fascinating.
Yeah.
I mean, you stare at her because you're trying to figure out what's going on in there.
Yeah,
and she's a wonderful character.
A great example like of ways that she makes a scene is, there's a scene at the end of season two where she's on the phone and Trisha, President Walker's wife, is called to thank her for all she's done, when we know how much she's done to destroy their presidency. And she goes, Claire, you're a good person. And Claire goes, thank you. And she hangs up, and she's just come back from out of town. And she sat down on the steps, you know, and there was this breaking down into sobs, right, which I had written. I wrote that part.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, I might be able to cry, I might not be able to, but just let me do my thing, and whatever you do, go with it. And what makes this scene is not her sobbing, but what Robin did after the sobbing, which I never could have written, which is she stops crying, and then she has this suitcase, one of those rollaways with the handle, right? And she does this thing where she goes, it's like zip, like all that emotion I just felt, I can only indulge it for so long, and in her case about 10 seconds, and then I'm going to swallow it. And then she, you know, with the suitcase, turns and heads up those steps. And that's what makes her Claire. Right. Not the fact that she felt bad and wept some tears. Anyone can do that. Yeah. But her ability to thickly interior the forest.
Thickly
forest the
but
interior.
FDR, there's this moment in the film when one of his aides sees him, right? And he's just very, very briefly looks.
Yeah, there's a wonderful moment at Campobello. He's gone back there the first time that I think he's been back since he was stricken. And he's president of the United States. And he's alone in the woods, and some of the party comes across him, and he's got this just anguished look on his face. And we've come across it once before with Ossie Davis startling Louis Armstrong in a studio where they're shooting a movie together, and a person who's perpetually happy with the big smile, "It's a Wonderful World," and "Hello, Dolly," and you know, whatever. You know, he catches Frank, you know, in this moment of real great sadness, and then all of a sudden he sees him, and the mask comes back up, and just as Armstrong starts going to Ossie Davis, "Oh, you caught Pops," like this, and then it's done. But you begin to see the kind of, you know, this is kabuki theater, that we all possess these fairly durable masks that protect us in sort of most situations, and when we permit them to drop, we've got this momentary glimpse. It's so interesting to get in there. But what's more interesting than the glimpse, as you're suggesting, is the way in which that facade is quickly reestablished.
If you want power as the prize, the price is that you don't have the luxury of weakness. And that's not just to the rest of the world, it's to yourself.
To yourself, yeah.
You know, when Orson Welles came to the White House to meet Roosevelt, Roosevelt said to him, "Mr. Welles, there are two great actors in America. You are the other one."
Welles also said that all of Shakespeare's greatest characters were villains. And if you think about that, that's true.
Yeah.
There's Iago. There's
Macbeth.
We're in a theater.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
Right.
Oh man.
You're talking to the. You've broken
you
the wall.
You, that is a terrible thing you just did. No, I'm very superstitious about that. But you know, even Hamlet is a villain if you really think about it. And Richard III, maybe the greatest Shakespearean villain.
Yep.
And so when people also ask me, like, you know, why don't you do a show about a good guy, a good politician? I'm like, well, villains are more fun.
Yeah, more fun.
I want to ask one more question. We're leading into the midterm elections, then it's going to be this incredibly expensive, long presidential campaign for 2016. I want to ask each of you kind of quickly what you think, what you want viewers to take away from your series that sort of informs or inspires the way we think about contemporary politics.
Well, don't settle for less than real leadership. I mean, that seems to me that's the message of this show. That those people knew where they wanted to go, and they knew how to move people along, and they knew how to do all the politics you were talking about. And we shouldn't settle for less.
Yeah, I agree. I think that you know, when you're telling a story, it really doesn't matter. We want to tell a complicated story, and then you set it out and it becomes yours. I think what's so clear in history, that as Jeff was saying before, you know, human nature doesn't change. And as you investigate in a kind of authentic way the dimensions of a human character that went before, they speak to you in the present. And I think what's nice about the Roosevelts is that they seem very familiar. Their things are common, and they remind us what authenticity, as Jeff is suggesting, represents. And we have self-selected a rather pathetically low expectation of this process, and they remind us that it could be not just a higher calling. I mean, these are very manipulative and complicated people, but we can have people who are authentically themselves. That was the thing that united all three of the Roosevelts. They didn't pretend to be people that they weren't. They may have erected the facade that protected themselves and the rest of the world from the exposure to the pain. But Theodore Roosevelt did not do anything to change that Coke bottle glasses or that Harvard accent or that thing that must have just hastened forward quickly there, that cracked the cowboys up. But after a while, they realized, you know what? He's just himself.
It's who he is.
It is who he is. And it would be nice to see a political process that, and this is as much on you, the media, the reporters of it, the intermediaries, as it is on the politicians themselves, in which you have a kind of combination of real substantive kind of conversation, that it isn't just gotcha, that we don't have that false expectation that everyone be perfect, that we understand that in everyone is a negotiation, a very complex negotiation between strengths and weaknesses, and that's what defines heroism. And perfection is nowhere in that equation, and the expectation of it is shallow, and that once we release ourselves from that, then we get to participate in the complexity that life actually is, and not the kind of superficiality, the surface that we seem to constantly stay on all the time in our process.
I mean, I think that first of all, House of Cards is meant no way at all to influence anything in this town or any other. But speaking for myself, since I'm here, I'll say two things. I mean, one is to piggyback on what Ken said about we're looking, perfection, right? These perfect leaders, and I think we often want two contradictory things from our leaders. We want them to be totally perfect saints on the one hand, that do no wrong, that have no flaws, that are incapable of moral ambiguity, and then on the other hand, we want effective leaders. And effective leaders often have to do very pragmatic, ruthless things that we ourselves don't want to do, and that's why we don't run for office, because we don't want to have to make the decision whether to send people to war. We don't want to have to make the decision like, okay, is this person going to get less in terms of, a tax break, even though I know they really need it, because we don't have the money and I'm making those choices. These are very hard, brutal things that politicians must do in order to be effective. And sometimes they have to lie and they have to cheat to be effective as well. FDR, Teddy, great examples of that. And so we want both those things, and you're not going to get them both. You're going to get a mixture. And I think it's important to remember that, because we don't give people a lot of leeway these days to be large and contain multitudes. And I would add to that that one of the things I like about the show is the direct address, because it gives you a certain, as the audience, complicity. Right, like you get to be in on the fun. You, by having access to this guy, sort of feel like you're part of the scheme, whether you want to be or not. And complicity for me is a really interesting concept, because there's a lot of ways to be complicit. One way is to be active. Another way is to be passive, watching a television show and sort of delighting in this guy's romp through DC. But complicity is much more serious when it comes to politics. I think that we have the leaders that we deserve. The onus is not on them, it's on you. So if you're unhappy with Washington, it's not their fault.
I agree.
Now, Rick Schneider from WETA is going to make some remarks.
Thank you.